Hello, welcome to my channel once again. Today I am bringing you a video of an African American who has lived almost all her life in America, but she's a Nigerian. She is saying she prefers Ghana to Nigeria because of a particular experience that she had. But she is Nigerian. Her parents, everyone is Nigerian, but she prefers Ghana to Nigeria. I want us to go into this video and listen to what she said, her reason for choosing Ghana over Nigeria.
Akwaba from Accra, Ghana. For those who know, I spend Easter here in Ghana every year for the last 4 years. And I always get the same question. Why do I go to Ghana instead of Nigeria, seeing that I'm Nigerian? And I'm going to tell you the story time of my first ever flight to Nigeria. And it's actually the reason why I only fly business class now. So when I was 25, it was the first ever time I ever went to Nigeria. I was born in America. My parents assimilated to American culture very early. They arrived in America in the 1980s. They had me in 1984. So I've always known just America. They didn't speak Yoruba at home to us, and the only Nigerian culture we really got was just eating jollof rice or eating the food or Nigerian parties and like Fuji music. But other than that, like, we didn't really learn a lot about Nigeria, and they never went back. So when I finally went to Nigeria for the first time, it was 25 on my own dime. And when I was traveling at 25, I didn't really care about like where I sat or choosing my seats or anything like that. And this trip taught me that I should really pay attention. So I'm flying from Toronto to Paris, Paris to Nigeria on Air France. Is also the last ever time I flew Air France, because though you get like a sunny disposition from the British Airways, from Emirates and those other airlines, Paris, French people lived to the hype. They was super rude. On top of that, I had a long layover in Paris airport, Charles de Gaulle. And Charles de Gaulle is basically a Greyhound station. It's not meant for long time layover because the seats is hard, the airport is cold, and there's nothing to eat. But I really noticed the flight attendant's attitude on the Paris to Lagos leg. So now it's time to board. We're getting on. I don't know what seat I'm in until they print my boarding pass. I'm in row 37. I'm closer to the bathroom than I am the pilot. This will be the last time in Jesus' name, right? So the super sunny welcomes and things like that you get from flight attendants on BA and on Emirates, even KLM, Paris, Air France is the bottom tier. And I can tell why, because when we get on this plane, passengers is not paying attention and they're not listening. And flying from Canada, like, I'm so used to compliance. Canadians comply. I haven't been on a plane. Like, at this time, I live in Toronto. Flying from Canada, Canadians comply. They sit down, they're quiet, they clap when you land like moos, but they comply. I'm not flying out of America, so we haven't hit that COVID time yet where passengers is cutting up. So Nigeria really reset my chemistry as to seeing how passengers and flight personnel behave. So we're on the plane, we're in row 37. The flight attendants got a bit of a funky attitude, like they're impatient when you're asking for stuff and when they're taking your order for drinks and things like that. A little bit of a funky attitude, but when we start to land, we are in descent. The plane is angled down like this. And the passenger in the aisle seat, so I'm in the aisle, 1, 2, 3, I'm the window, 1, 2, 3, I'm that seat. The passenger in the middle aisle seat next to me decides this is the opportune time to take down his luggage. Now, you know when they say, like, be careful opening the overhead compartment because items may have shifted? They're saying that when the plane has landed. Imagine the items when the plane is in an acute angle and we are about to touch grass. We are literally angled, flying at the speed of damn light towards the ground. He decides this is the perfect time to open the overhead compartment. He opens it and one of the bags falls out and hits the lady in the seat in front of him. She thinks that the plane is falling apart. She starts to, this auntie starts to scream, "They've killed me! They've killed me!" Which is making everyone now look around to see what's going on. He is oblivious. He's standing on his seat. The flight attendant is buckled into the jump seat. They're screaming down the aisle for him to sit down. He is standing on the seat, pulling bags down. The bags, people's coats, is falling out. He does not care. The man in the seat in front of me, we're going to call him Nollywood actor because his American accent was the most forced thing I've ever heard in my life. Like, it sounded like he did voice coaching for a Nollywood movie where the actor goes to America and comes back, right? Yo, guy, what are you doing? The uncle pulling the bags looks back at him like he's a fly on the floor. Keeps pulling the bags. He's like, are you crazy? Now, if you know a Nigerian, calling them crazy is fighting words. So he turns around. Uncle with the bags is like, how dare you call me crazy? Do you know who I am? Which is the most Nigerian phrase you could ever hear. If you ever want to hear somebody inflate their sense of importance, this is the phrase. Nollywood actor says the most craziest comeback. I still use it to this day. Like, you guys think I'm quick-witted. He says, if you were somebody, you wouldn't be in row 37 now. Let me tell you, everybody around us starts to laugh. And so he's starting to get mad. He wants to fight Nollywood actor, who is a good 20 years younger than him. The auntie who got the bag jumped on her head is like, oh, don't fight. Imagine you just got assaulted with a bag and now she's trying to smooth things over. I'm sitting there. I feel like I'm in the WWF. I'm sitting there expecting like a full on smackdown to happen. And he finally calms down. Uncle with the bag finally calms down and sits down. Nollywood actor finally calms down and sits down. And we land. And I remember just turning my data on and calling my mom and being like, get me the hell up out of here. And that was kind of my introduction to Nigeria. I noticed that you need a certain level of weary or madness to like survive there. And I don't have it. Like, I came to Nigeria thinking I was going on vacation. It's my mom's youngest sister, so my aunt's 50th birthday, and it's Mother's Day weekend. So I'm thinking I'm going there to spend time, have an amazingly normal time. Nigeria is not built for vacation. And funny enough, out of all the crazy things that happened, I end up like going to Ghana. And that's kind of how I ended up here. KLM and Delta have like a ride share or a code share. And I get an email the week I'm supposed to leave, basically saying that there's no pilot and they have to move my flight back 3 days. And I'm like, who told y'all I could fly on Wednesday when I'm supposed to be leaving on Sunday? So I'm on hold with Delta. It's 8 a.m. I'm on hold with Delta for 4 hours. My phone is on the charger. We're all hearing the hold music. And when they come on, they're like, well, there's nothing we can do. You have no pilot. My dad is like, ask them if you can use, I'm flying Delta back. He's like, ask them if you can use your credit on KLM, which is cool, but I don't know where KLM flies out of. So I'm like, yeah. Okay, they say that I can. They put the credit on my account for me to buy a ticket. I turned to my dad like, there's no KLM out of Lagos Airport. So he's like, you can fly to Ghana. Now, being a product of the American school system, I have no clue where Ghana is. He could have told me Uzbekistan. I was like, okay. He was like, it's only a 40-minute flight. Come to find out, there is an airline called Africa Worldwide that flies out of Lagos 2 times a day, 6:30 a.m., 6:30 p.m. It's noon. It's also Mother's Day weekend. So I'm sitting there like, okay, how am I going to get to Ghana? I go on the website. Everything is sold out except for that day, Thursday, 6:30 p.m. It's noon and we're in Ibadan. So technically, it's supposed to be an hour away, but Nigeria traffic is 4 hours away. We get to Lagos Airport at 4:30. I get on the 6:30 flight. I'm in Ghana. I don't even have a hotel. I just put on my Snapchat, like, whoever's in Ghana, tell me what the hell to do, because I have never been here before. And people bombard me with, like, clubs, restaurants, hotels. It was amazing. And because of the size of Accra, which is, like, a third the size of Lagos, getting around is so easy. There's Uber. I had a blast. I remember my first time out in Ghana. I went to 6 clubs. I went from like front back to Mood, back to front back to Bloom Bar to a place called Ace. I get out of Ace, the sun is out. I'm like, I left my hotel at 7 p.m. It's 7 a.m. And they're still thinking about going somewhere else. I was like, if y'all is kidnapping me, just let me know. Bring me back to my damn hotel. But I've had a blast since, and I've come back ever since. Like, to me, Accra is just a lot easier to get around. And Ghanaians are calmer than Nigerians. And as a Nigerian, I'm speaking from my own truth. I know people are going to come to the comments and defend Nigeria to the death, and I always will because I'm Nigerian by blood. But let's tell the truth and shame the devil, right? So to me, just Ghana is just a lot calmer, and I love it. So I'm here for the week. Have a blessed day, guys.
Yes, for me, I think things happen, you know. It's just unfortunate, the experience that she had in that flight and going into the country for the first time and all that. Maybe if she decided to put all that behind her and went into the country and tried to mingle up with people, she might have definitely had some good experience. I don't think one bad experience should define a whole country, you understand? That is actually my stance, because I'm Ghanaian. I'm happy she's in Ghana, she's enjoying herself, and she loves to come here. And another thing that I think I picked from her conversation or whatever she was saying is that I think she's the type that she doesn't want that chaotic environment. She doesn't want to be in that chaotic environment. She just wants to be in a very cool, calm place. And definitely anyone who has traveled to Nigeria and Ghana would attest to the fact that Ghana is very cool, is very calm. Ghana is like totally the opposite of Nigeria. Let's say Lagos, because I'm very sure there are other states in Nigeria that are also very cool, you know? Yes, but I think with the experience, for me, I don't think that should have been a decision not to go to her own country, you know? For me, it doesn't sit well. I don't think it justifies her reason not to go to Nigeria, you understand? Yes, but I'm sure she had good time in Ghana. She had a splendid experience in Ghana, and that is the reason why she has chosen Ghana over Nigeria. All the same, it is the same Africa. It doesn't matter wherever she goes. I feel it wasn't a reason enough. Maybe it was a reason enough for her, but for me, I don't think it was a reason enough. I thank you so much for watching.